I'd like to introduce the man whose idea this all was. Griffin Mill, please.
Thank you, Joel. You gotta have another drink. I'd like to extend my thanks to the patrons of the Los Angeles County Museum. You have long fostered the art of motion pictures as a serious and valuable art form in this community. Many people across the country and around the world have for too long thought of movies as a popular entertainment more than serious art. And I'm afraid a large majority of the press supports this attitude. We want great films with long shelf lives. We want the films of the new John Hustons, Orson Welles, Frank Capra. We and the other major film studios have a responsibility to the public to maintain the art of motion pictures as our primary mandate. Movies are art, now more than ever. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Claude Curvin, and welcome to New York Film Academy's online writing program. Now, I know what you're probably thinking, what am I doing out on the street? I should be behind a desk with a shelf of books behind me and a globe and maybe a computer. But actually, for what we're going to talk about today, that's not going to be necessary. And besides, it's such a nice day in New York, I thought we'd stroll around while we talk about the program. So come on with me. First of all, let me say how happy I am to be doing this with you. I've been teaching writing and directing at the New York Film Academy for about 10 years now, but this is the first online course I've ever done. So I guess in a matter of speaking, I'm as new to this as you are. Just had to stop for a cup of coffee. So why don't we start by talking a little bit about the course objectives. Well, to put it simply, you're going to be writing a feature-length screenplay. A screenplay that I think you'll find is the best and most thoughtful work you've ever done. But more than that, no one can become a professional writer after just one script. So I hope that you leave this program with an understanding of how to teach yourself. And that starts with reading lots of screenplays. Because by now you're probably very experienced at watching films, but if you're anything like my other students, you haven't read many scripts. And my advice is if you want to learn how to write, you have to read. Read as many screenplays as you can. Because let's face it, it's one thing to know how it looks on the screen. It's another to know how it reads on the page. And let's face it, if it doesn't read well on the page, no one's ever going to see it on the screen. Okay, now I know you're dying to hear about the program and how it's going to work. Well, here's how it's going to go.
In an effort to give you both the theory and the hands-on practical experience of writing, we've divided the program into lecture classes and writing workshop classes. The live interactive writing workshops will be held on Tuesdays, beginning Tuesday, September 15th at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, and will run approximately 2 hours. You'll be given ample notice should a change of schedule be necessary. And if you're not available for the live class, there'll be a transcript available every week for downloading. The lecture classes will cover topics germane to your writing assignment each week. They will be available for downloading or streaming on Wednesdays, beginning Wednesday, September 16th, and will remain posted throughout the duration of your program should you need to refer back to a particular topic. Each lecture will run approximately 30 minutes.
So here we are inside the New York Film Academy, our Soho facility to be specific. So come on with me, I'm going to show you where our classroom is. Hey, here we are. This is our room. You know, this classroom gets used for all kinds of things, for acting classes, directing classes, camera classes. Hey, here's someone left over from the last camera class. Haven't wrapped that light yet, have you, Matt? All right, as you can see, we're still getting settled in. I promise next week we're going to have some more props around here to make it a little more homey. Right, Heather?
Yes, we do.
Thank you very much, Heather. This is my backdrop. What do you think of that? I think that's pretty cool. And I used to live right over there. Anyway, why don't we get into today's topic, which is, what the heck is a story anyway? You know, it's a funny thing. We're bombarded with stories everywhere we look, in books and movies, on television. But have you ever really stopped to think about what makes a story a story? Most of us don't, until we try to sit down and write one.
Well, generally speaking, when we're writing a story, we need three things. Well, it's true, we need a beginning, middle, and end, but really that has to do more with the story's structure, and we'll talk about that in another class. And please don't call out next time. Now, firstly, we need a character, someone or something for the audience to connect to. Secondly, we need an objective, something for the character to do, something that's really important to them. And thirdly, we need an obstacle, something which makes achieving that objective difficult, really difficult. Hey, damn near impossible most of the time, right? Now, in most stories, we have one main character, what we call a single protagonist. And here are a few that you might remember.
Did you run out on me because you couldn't take it, because you knew what it would be like? Hiding from the police, running away all the time?
You can believe that if you want to.
Oh, what? Your mother of the year? You treat her like an employee.
Murphy, 7-3, La Mata.
La Mata has won the fight.
And it keeps getting funnier every single time I see it. Not to mention the fact that you're talking to a dead guy. Now, what do you think?
You know, they don't even have to be human.
Huh. Enough wolves in the world already.
They don't even have to be animate. In fact, anything can be a protagonist as long as you can give it human qualities. Even an antibody. But we can have more than one protagonist. We could have two. Or what we call dual protagonists. Now here are some famous movies featuring dual protagonists. See how many of the films you can name. I'll give you a few seconds.
Why here?
I don't follow.
Well, all this effort to get transferred. It's the first question that popped into my head.
I guess the same reasons as you. The same reasons you had before you decided to quit, yeah?
So perverse. I'm just jealous because I know when that thing's over, man, he's gonna come back to you.
National bikini tour, and we're looking for two oil boys who can grease us up before each competition.
You are in luck. There's a town about 3 miles that way. I'm sure you'll find a couple guys there.
But two's not the limit. We can have any number of protagonists. It's what we call a group protagonist. Now, what defines a group protagonist is that all the characters share a common goal. For example, they're all trying to rob the bank, as in Ocean's 11. Or they're all trying to kill the German high command, as in The Dirty Dozen. Or they're all trying to save the village from bandits, as in The Seven Samurai. Or trying to save the last survivors of a dying civilization, as in Galaxy Quest. But there's still another kind of story in which you have groups of characters who don't share the same goal, in which they have individual goals. It's kind of like a series of short stories combined into one. Well, we call these multiple protagonist stories. Now, what gives these stories unity is their theme. Multiple protagonist stories are very popular right now. See if you can identify the theme of these familiar movies.
Thank you for coming down here, though. I suspect it has been a pointless journey.
Why would you say that?
Bueno, pues, I hear these stories. Your husband in jail, his business in chaos, various people fighting with the scraps.
My husband was a victim of an informer in your organization, not in ours.
That is not true, Mrs. Ayala. Your route has been compromised. Perhaps it is time for me to deal with other distributors in California.
I don't think you're gonna do that.
You don't?
No. My husband was working on something he called the Project for the Children. Are you aware of this?
Hey. Maybe they didn't tell you, but I've been reassigned.
Yeah, they told me. I just wanted to say good luck. And it was good riding with you.
You too.
Wait till you've been on the job a few more years.
Yeah.
Look at me. Look at me. Wait till you've been doing it a little longer. You think you know who you are. You have no idea.
Yo, Gomez. You ready to roll, homie?
Ready, amigo.
You shouldn't have done it!
Close
your goddamn eyes!
You murderer. You just let them lie there on the street. These two little girls just let them die like dogs. I should have killed you. You disappear. Don't even go back to the motel and get your things. Just disappear.
Makes me curious to see you in this neighborhood. He's clean. And if I can slander my own environment, it makes me sad, this regression. Plus, I don't know if it's beyond some fucking cock prick like Queen and to pull you out of the stadies and send you after me. I just can't know. I don't know what they do in that particular department anyway.
Well, I'm afraid we're unable to communicate with any of the aircraft.
Why?
As you may recall, sir, one of the provisions of Plan R provides that once the go code is received, the normal SSB radios in the aircraft are switched into a special coded device, which I believe is designated as CRM-114. Now, in order to prevent the enemy from issuing fake or confusing orders, CRM-114 is designed not to receive at all.
Now, the second thing you need is an objective. My protagonist has to want something. A goal, a need, a desire. And it has to be powerful. I mean, it's very hard to write a compelling story in which my character is in pursuit of something that doesn't mean anything to them. Because you know what? If they don't care, why should the audience care? In fact, the more your character feels about attaining their objective, the more your audience is going to match their emotion. Which is why we often choose characters who want things desperately. Now here's a few that I think you might remember.
Thank you.
Lastly, you need obstacles. I mean, if my character is thirsty and all he has to do is reach across the desk to get a drink, well, you know what? That's not very compelling, is it? On the other hand, plunge my character into the middle of a desert, and now you've got a story. Because to have drama, you have to have conflict. Nothing achieved easily in drama is of any significance. In fact, the only thing that has any meaning at all are those things that are achieved through great effort and sacrifice. And whether those obstacles come from another person, or from society, or from the environment, or even from inside the character themselves, we want to make these obstacles powerful. I mean, extremely powerful. Certainly more powerful than the protagonist, because let's face it, we root for David, not Goliath. Now here's a brief summary of the concepts covered in today's class. Well, generally speaking, when we're writing a story, we need three things. What we need, first of all, is we need a character, someone or something for the audience to connect to. Secondly, we need an objective, something for the character to do, something that they want, something that they must have. And thirdly, we need an obstacle, something which will make achieving that objective more difficult. Now, in most stories, we have one main character, what we call a single protagonist. But we can have more than one protagonist. We can have two, or what we call dual protagonists. But two's not the limit. We can have any number of protagonists. I mean, that's what we call group protagonists. What defines a group protagonist is that all the characters share a common goal. But there's another kind of story in which you have groups of characters who don't share the same goal, in which they have individual goals. It's kind of like a series of short stories combined all into one. Well, we call these multiple protagonist stories. And what gives these stories unity is their theme. Multiple protagonist stories are very popular now. Well, thanks for coming. It was fun. I'll see you next time here at the New York Film Academy.